name of the living God, creator, redeemer, and sustainer. Amen. When did your life begin? What memories do you still have of that life beginning? Who or what objects are the witnesses to those memories or experiences? Some of us treasure those early photographs, or some people have those notches on doors that remind us of how we grew as children. Or we have toys that we keep as kind of relics of those earlier memories. And we regard them as kind of holy treasures. They help us recall those days when our lives began and our personalities were formed and life happened. And the connection between the external proof of these formative and primary experiences, the photographs and the markers and the childhood relics, sometimes it's our houses, is only secondary to the internal, almost cinema-like graphic memory that goes on inside each one of us. The external may or may not help us to get in touch with our life's beginnings and those formative experiences. They are moments of bliss and moments of terror. A smell or a certain way the daylight will pass over a wall or a space on a given day can take us back. For me, there are a couple of memories that I want to share, early memories. One was walking with my mother, and my brother was in the child carriage that my mother was pushing, and I must have been 4 or 5 years old, and I was holding on to, we called it a pram, and our dog, we had this beautiful collie dog that was walking alongside us, and I can still remember the sound of a dumpster truck squealing brakes behind us as the dog was run over. And my mother said, "Let's just keep walking, keep walking, keep walking." And that was a kind of the first time I was exposed to the fragility of life as a child. And so that photograph is inside me. And then another experience when I was 4 or 5, again, not much, again, very young, but my maternal grandfather died, and he was laid out in a coffin in the room I was born in. And I can remember being lifted over, somebody lifted me over his coffin, and I remember seeing the white cloth and the white hair and the black tie and seeing my grandfather there. And seeing how adults behaved very differently, people that I, you know, my parents and my uncles and my aunts, how they were behaving differently at this experience, at the loss of our patriarch in our family. And then another moment, my cousin took me to the church where I was baptized a couple of months old, and he had a meeting with the vicar in the sacristy, and he left me in the choir stalls by myself. And I can remember I was maybe 5. My little legs were sticking out. They weren't long enough to be on the ground, but I can remember sitting in that space on my own, not really knowing what this place was, but I can remember the light dancing on my face and on my body, the colors of the stained glass window, they were hitting me and kind of tickling me, and the yellows and the reds and the blues. And it was a kind of feeling of warmth and connection and love. And I didn't know what it was. We would call that a religious experience. But it was the place where I had, a few years before, been baptized and received as a child of God. And so those are memories of both the traumas and the questions, the fragility of life, and the blessings. These, we all have those memories inside us. And I think about Jesus. You know, he was born a couple of weeks ago, and now he's all grown up getting baptized. But what happened in between? Right? And we don't know much about what happened in between. I visited the hometown of Nazareth, just a couple of blocks, tiny little place. And this is where he would have grown up, and he would have played in those streets. He would have climbed the mount when he would return later as an adult to preach the Sermon on the Mount. The village of Sepphoris, I talked a couple of weeks ago about maybe he and his dad, the carpenter, worked in this very fancy gated community. Well, Sepphoris was, there was a rebellion. And about 4 BC, the emperor sent an army to basically wipe everybody out or send them into slavery. And the place was set afire. And that would have been in the memory of the community that Jesus would have grown up, this violence and the devastation. And there was a Roman garrison in Caesarea Philippi just down the road. And there were things that the community you couldn't talk about. So Jesus, those were formative experiences that Jesus would have grown up with. These would have been pictures in his own mind as he was trying to make sense of who he was. And there are two photographs of Jesus that I want to talk about today. The first is linked to our Old Testament reading. And I can remember sitting in that little synagogue, tiny little room, where Jesus would have grown up as a little boy. And one day, the leader of the synagogue gave him this text to read and interpret. And he takes the book of the prophet Isaiah, and he talks about the people of Israel are called to proclaim the good news of releasing the captives and healing those who are ill and damaged and blind and excluded. And he does this audacious thing. He says, in your hearing, this text is fulfilled. And it's interesting because, you know, we love it when kids that we know from godly play, they grow up and you see them reading the lessons and we go, they probably had the same experience. Oh, that's little Jesus. Look at little Jesus reading and now interpreting, and they all were very proud of him. But they didn't like what he said. And what he talked about was that because they were kind of very narrow in their view of religion and God and nationalism, and he chooses his words very carefully, but he chooses two examples of where God chooses not obvious people to bring about salvation and healing. And the people didn't like it. And they didn't like it so much that they drove him out of the synagogue and they went to this bluff, this hill, that's still called the Hill of Rejection, still there, and they were going to throw him over the hill. I would imagine that if he went in front of the Commission on Ministry today, that he probably would not be ordained. That his first experience of his experience in the church, of all the sermons and all the things you got to do, they wouldn't have approved that. So that's one photograph of Jesus, a trauma that, you know, that in John's gospel, it's almost that mirror. He came to his own people and his own people rejected him. And that's going to play out on a larger picture later on in the story. So that's one picture. The second picture is the baptism of Jesus. This idea that Jesus comes to John and he is baptized in the River Jordan and he comes out of the river. And again, there's this wonderful juxtaposition between the rejection, the people that you think would be loving and supportive are not, and this wide, open, expansive, free space of the Jordan Valley and the crystal flowing river. And he hears this voice, you are my son, my beloved, in whom I am well pleased. Right? And that juxtaposition of how we connect. And that, in many ways, is the beginning of the affirmation of Jesus to begin his ministry. And it's a way in which, so I like to think of these two stories, these two pictures, and maybe connect that to our own faith journey. And to think about, move from that question, where did your life begin, to where did your life in Christ begin? Where did your life in Christ begin? And for many of us, it began when somebody carried us into church and prayed over us and baptized us, and gifts were given to us, and an identity was given to us, and we began the journey. And then throughout our lives, there may be periods where we renewed that commitment as young adults, I remember when I was 16, a kind of conversion experience of accepting Christ in a kind of much more authentic way. But Christ was already there. It wasn't that I was kind of turning it on and off, but I could see it in a way and accepted it in a way and began to respond to what I considered the grace and the goodness of God in my life and the generosity of the people of God that were helping me along the way. And so you might have stories as well about if we were to talk about how and when did your life in Christ begin? And it could have been something that you were brought up with, or it could have been something that broke in much later. And it was only much later that I began to see something that the seeds were already sown in me. And I think Jesus probably went through that kind of process as well in his own awareness. But the point of today is to think about the baptism as a beginning, as an affirmation. And that the idea that not only is Jesus the Son of God, in whom God is well pleased, but each one of us, that we are sons and daughters of God, in whom we are well pleased, in whom God is well pleased, and how we live that out, and how we live that out in our lives. And it's really hard to proclaim that. You think of what's going on, you turn on the television, the news today, those poor people in that plane in Iran. You think of all those people who suddenly were killed, and those families, and that loss and suffering, and all the devastation in Australia that's going on, and all the things in the world. And it's into these moments. You think of what we went through in our own congregation this week with the loss of the ropes, right? And somehow this idea that we get back to what baptism is about, you know, we are eternally part of God. We are sons and daughters of God in whom God is well pleased. So may that inspire us as we move into a new year, as we move into a new chapter in our common life in St. Paul's, and as we see these stories maybe differently. When did our life begin? When did our life in Christ